I think we should take a little trip. Take a trip with me. With that man right there. Let's go on a trip to President Trump's fantasyland. Everything he says, it's rosy. Everything's up, everything's getting better, he says. Even as Robert Mueller's probe is looking worse and worse for his White House. So before I show you what Trump is saying, I want to show you a brand new CNN poll out this morning. It's new approval ratings data showing President Trump at 35%. This matches his record low in CNN's polling, and he remains at a historically low level for a president at this point in his presidency. 35%. I want to show you that data first before I show you the fantasyland version. This is the spin that's out there, courtesy of Judge Jeanine Pirro on Fox News. Now, here's the thing. President Trump called into Pirro's show last night, and she went over the top in her praise of him. Watch.
There's a poll that puts you at 50%, and at CPAC, you're at 93% approval rating. You did all this in 1 year with the economy.
Okay, did you see what you put on screen there? That CPAC poll. That was a straw poll taken of the attendees of the annual conservative conference. Now, obviously, most of the people there are very supportive of President Trump. That's not a surprise. That's like asking people at a Yankees game how much they love the Yankees, okay? Even better, okay, would be asking about the Eagles, given that the Eagles won the Super Bowl. Now, President Trump calls into Pirro's show. He gets all this positive reinforcement. He gets told how his approval ratings are soaring, when in fact, let's put that CNN data back up on screen, he's at 35%. Now, you'll notice Pirro mentioned some other poll, 50%. That's a Rasmussen poll that actually is not strong enough. It's not the kind of poll that outlets like CNN even cite because it doesn't meet our standards. It doesn't even call people on cell phones. It only calls landlines. Anyway, I think this is an example of Trump's fantasy land. He's willing to give an interview to one of his friends who tells him how great he is, where the real data tells a story that's much worse, much more troubling for his White House. We've seen this over and over again recently. The president says one thing in his fantasy land when the facts show otherwise. This weekend, he's saying that the Democratic memo that's supposed to rebut the Nunes memo, he says the memo is nothing, when in fact, the Democratic memo made a lot of news. And now, it seems President Trump was watching the coverage of this memo on Fox on Saturday. You could tell because he was basically live tweeting Fox News. But even when Fox News told him the truth, even when Fox got it right, President Trump got it wrong. I want to show you this because it's a really stark example of the president misquoting what he's hearing. Here's something the president tweeted. Let's put his tweet on screen about Schiff. He says, Congressman Schiff omitted and distorted key facts. You can see there's quote marks with attribution to Fox News. Now, obviously, then Trump goes on to attack Schiff. But the point is, he's quoting Fox News saying that Schiff was distorting key facts. Where did he get that from? I wondered, where was he getting that from? So I looked it up. Here is the soundbite from Fox News where he got it.
Congressman Schiff, he argues the Republican memo omitted and distorted key facts.
Okay, did you see what just happened there? This is kind of remarkable. The Fox News anchor correctly quoted Adam Schiff saying that the Republican memo distorted key facts. So you have Schiff, a Democrat, criticizing the Republican memo. President Trump took five words out of the quote, turned the quote around, made it about Schiff. If I did that in English class, I would be given an F. I would flunk the assignment. But this is what President Trump does all the time. He takes something that he wants to believe and he says that it happened. This is what I mean by a fantasy land. And we've also been seeing this in the wake of the mass shooting in Florida. It was remarkable to see the president leading these listening sessions at the White House. But now, when he's at CPAC, when he's calling into Pirro's show, he's promoting this idea of arming more and more teachers. Let's take a look at how he framed this discussion at CPAC.
The teacher would have shot the hell out of him before he knew what happened.
This ridiculous rhetoric has to stop. This is part of Trump's fantasy land. First of all, the national debate about this should be about stopping all shootings, not just school shootings. This shouldn't just be about teachers and students. Second, this is fantasy land thinking. Let's take the Las Vegas massacre. There were many officers, both at the concert and inside the Mandalay Bay Hotel, and yet 58 people still died. We've got to provide the proper context for these ridiculous quotes that are out there. Even if President Trump prefers to live in a fantasy land, journalists have to at least try to help him see the reality. Joining me now is Dan Rather, former anchor of the CBS Evening News. He currently anchors the News with Dan Rather on the Young Turks streaming network. And in Washington this weekend, Sarah Westwood, White House correspondent for the Washington Examiner, and Doug High, a CNN political commentator and former RNC communications director. Doug, let me start with you. Sometimes when I try to point out these misquotes, these misattributions, this sloppiness, this misleading rhetoric, I get a lot of people to respond to me on social media and say, Brian, we know, you don't need to tell us at this point. Is there any value anymore, Doug, in trying to point out the daily deflections and spin?
You know, there's so much noise these days that it's hard to filter things through. I think it's important to point out where things are right and wrong. And let me say in full disclosure, since you showed the Jeanine Pirro interview earlier, I had been invited on that show several times before I joined CNN. And I'm really proud to say that I said no every time, and not just because it was on a Saturday night. This show and other shows on Fox and other shows on other networks, I think take their rhetoric to the extreme. I think there's no better example of that than Jeanine Pirro's show, is why I'm proud that I always said no to their show. But look, yeah, of course, it's important to hold any politician accountable. I will say, though, as a conservative, there are a lot of us who feel that all the fact checkers who have set themselves up to be essentially independent arbiters of truth have their own biases that need to be brought out. And that's why you see so many negative reactions from not just Republicans on Capitol Hill, but folks at CPAC and conservatives in the media as well. Fact-checking is important, but we need to make sure that it's done on an even-handed level. Trump creates some of the biases against him on his own, which is its own problem.
Sarah, what's your impression? You were at CPAC for a few days. You heard President Trump up there on stage. He was giving really a campaign-style stump speech. Is this what he prefers to be doing, trying to go back to what worked so well for him during the campaign?
I think we've seen that more and more, whether it's calling into a Fox show, which was a tactic that he deployed very frequently during the campaign to allow him to sort of blitz all media coverage, to these more freewheeling speeches, which is obviously his preference, rather than giving the structured kind of remarks that are required of a president. President Trump really feeds off the energy of crowds. So the CPAC crowd was very friendly. I think that his speech sort of went off the rails at certain points because he was sort of interacting with the audience. At one point, I'm sure you noticed, he inexplicably asked the audience to clap for whether they preferred tax cuts to the Second Amendment. It's something that doesn't totally make a lot of sense intellectually, but he was loving the fact that the crowd was loving him, and I think that amped him up a lot.
Dan Rather, as someone who has been covering presidents for decades, have you seen this kind of fantasy land thinking or behavior before?
No, we've certainly seen behavior we didn't like in presidents, but we've never seen anything like this. This is new, and I do think that most people get it, that most people understand that they're facing on a daily basis from the White House and from the president himself, the rough equivalent, you're facing a fertilizer spreader in a windstorm. And it's past the point of shock with the president. That Donald Trump, in his mind, you can argue he's delusional. He thinks he's triumphant. You say, well, he's 35% approval readers. How can he think that? I have no explanation for it, but that's what he thinks. He does have some things going for him, the economy being for one thing. But this business on guns and the shooting in Parkland, I think has damaged his standing. I think one reason you're seeing a drop in the polls for him, 35%. But I will say this, Brian, if you want to judge where President Trump, whether he's really in deep trouble, the mark is 30%. If his approval rating gets 30% or below, this is Richard Nixon country during Watergate, 30% or above, he can probably keep himself going and hold out some hope of keeping the House and the Senate in November.
He's been between 30 and 40. CNN had him at 40% last month, now back to 35. Gallup has him at 37 right now. He's been in this same range for a while. But you say we're beyond shock at this point. Do you think there's less use then in journalists trying to check the false claims?
Not only I think it's useful, I think it's absolutely imperative. Now more than ever is when the press needs to be a kind of truth squad for this and every other president. It's perhaps more important with President Trump because there are more untruths to set the record straight. But if journalists cower, as many in Congress, both some Republicans and some Democrats in Congress are cowering with the NRA, if journalists cower, then how long can we sing we're the home of the brave?
Last question in this block goes to Doug High, because Doug, you were a former RNC communications director. I know you've thought about this issue of guns for a long time. How much activism do you see in the coverage in the wake of Parkland, and how much do you think journalists are overstepping their bounds?
I see a ton of it. I think there are changes that could and should be made, but I see a ton of it on every day. And I'll tell you, if you talk to Republicans outside of Washington, D.C., on the issue of guns, abortion, gay marriage, climate change, they see an activist press that basically issues the talking points of the left every day. I was at a farm 2 weeks ago in Fletcher, North Carolina, a friend's farm of mine, where there was a big cookout. And what I heard so often was, talking about the press, was that the press essentially does act as the left. And so it's one thing to have conversations in New York and in Washington, D.C., but what people outside of the country see and hear every day is a press that they feel is against them, at least if you're talking to Republican voters, that not only echoes what Trump says, it means that they're listening to what Trump says, whether on the Jeanine Pirro show or other shows, and essentially taking marching orders from them. It's a very serious thing, and it's also why I think it's incumbent on the press to make sure that they get it right every time. If the press makes a mistake, it's not just viewed as a mistake, it's viewed as bias, and that's a problem that the press needs to deal with moving forward.